Okay, everybody, I think we're going to get started. Sorry, we had some technical difficulties, but they seem to have resolved. Thank you, Heather. Okay, so tonight we'd like to welcome you to our first public forum and hoping to get everybody's attention so that people can hear the presentation this evening. So just as a general welcome, thank you for those of you who bothered to come out here on a Tuesday night. We really appreciate it. And we also want to thank everybody in the viewing audience at home. So thank you, Richard, for broadcasting this. So first question that may be on folks' minds is why we're actually doing this. So this is something that I think we've done in a while here in town. And the primary reason is that the select board and the school committee and the finance committee, we've been meeting as a tri-board for a couple of years now. And it's no secret that we've been challenged a bit by some of the town finances in terms of looking forward. I mean, things have been going fairly well, but we know that we are at a crossroads. And what we mean by that is that the revenues that we have coming in aren't currently projected to keep pace with the expenses and the needs, the growing needs of the town. So tonight we do want to talk to you, though, about all of the things that are going well, or at least, well, probably not all of them, but some good subset of those. We want to hit the highlights and make sure everybody understands what's happening in town. Again, we can't continue on the current revenue and services path without making some changes. So somehow, some way, we either need to generate more revenue, we need to reduce our costs, or we need to find another way of delivering the services that our residents have come to expect. So before we get into that, first I wanted to express appreciation to fellow select board members and all of the other elected boards in town, the town administrator for his hard work on the presentation this evening, and the department heads in particular. A year ago, we asked our department heads to do something called a SWOT analysis, which, again, was probably not something familiar to many of them. But they went through and they spent an awful lot of time taking a look at their particular functional area, identifying particular strengths, weaknesses, opportunities for improvement, and also ongoing threats that might prevent them from being able to provide the services. And those SWOT analyses are really the basis for our presentation this evening and have provided a context for us to move forward. We'd like to thank all of the municipal employees who are delivering services day in and day out, even if they don't have the title of department head, because without their hard work, the rest of us wouldn't be able to do what we're trying to do. And also, all of the volunteers. I mean, again, we have elected boards, but we have appointed boards, and we have many people in town who participate on various subcommittees or just stop by the Council on Aging and help out when they can. So without that volunteer workforce, again, the town would not run. So as far as the format this evening, we're going to walk through a PowerPoint presentation. We'd like to tell you that we spent an awful lot of time making it fancy and pretty with sliders and things like that, but we did not. We focused on the content. Hopefully we'll improve this method to our madness going forward when we do this again. Our intent is to walk through the presentation, take questions, but take the questions in an orderly fashion at the end of kind of logical breaking points. And so the way that we've done this is we have an initial section on the town revenues, and then we're going to start talking about the delivery plan, so the expense side of it, and the schools will be making a separate presentation that's part of this as well. So just in terms of what we're hoping that you get out of this evening, we would love to tell you that our hope is that we'll be able to resolve all of the issues facing the town tonight. If you're expecting that, you're going to be sorely disappointed. But we are hoping to give you a very general sense of the finances of the town, again, to provide a context for sound decision making so that when you do come to town meeting or you're listening to the board meetings, that you have a better understanding of how those conversations fit within the context of a bigger picture. We're hoping that you will know where some of our challenges lie in the fact that the decision making may not quite be as simple as it might appear when you're only getting sound bites on the street. And hopefully, will you walk away with a keen sense of some of the key decision points that we're really going to be relying on our constituents to help provide input we don't think that it's appropriate for the select board or any particular group to make a strong recommendation on some of these things without offering you the opportunity for more feedback at a future point in time. So with that, I'd like to turn it over to our town administrator, David Dixon.
So good evening. We all know Hadley. Hadley's a town of 5,000 people, and I often say that's true between 2 a.m. and 5 a.m. Otherwise, there are 20 to 60,000 people in town. You got two sports arenas in town. You've got four or five shopping destinations in town. You've got two major commuting corridors. And so it's a testament to the town that we've been able to maintain a small town feel so that we know each other as neighbors and as friends. But we also have to deal with providing high quality services to a much larger town. And we face some of the issues of rising to the challenge of providing those high quality services to our business community, to our commuters, to our visitors, to the students. So we have strengths that we build upon. The first is that Hadley has an excellent financial management plan, and one of the ways that you can look at that is through the excellent credit rating, AA+ by Standard & Poor's. If we can go to the next slide, and so you can see the credit rating has improved over time. We started, when I first started here, it was A+, then it went to AA, then finally AA+, and that was recently reaffirmed in FY15 by the bonding agency when we went out for long-term borrowing. So there's been steady improvement to our credit rating. And just by comparison, the Commonwealth of Massachusetts credit rating is AA+, as is the United States of America. So we're not at the top at AAA, but we're doing quite well for a small town. So if we could go back one. All right, excellent credit rating allows us to borrow money at a reduced rate, so it's saving the money. It demonstrates to the world that we have excellent financial management, and that financial management and planning is carried out by the Finance Committee and by the financial management team. And our advisors, our chief financial advisor and other advisors on special trusts. So we spend a lot of time thinking about finances, planning for them, trying to anticipate what's coming up. And we've been able to do a good job of making the small town resources work. We have a very well balanced tax base, and I'll be dwelling upon that in the next couple of slides. We have cooperation among departments. We love work together as a team. We have regular communication. We want to get things done. That is not always the case in other town halls, so you're very fortunate to have a professional staff that works very well together and wants to work well together and communicates well and in a spirit of cooperation. Hadley has demonstrated leadership in open space preservation. We're number one in the Commonwealth, both in terms of number of acres of farmland preserved as well as a percentage of its land base preserved in farmland. And I'll talk a little bit about more about that. Leadership in renewable energy production, we're number one in the county. You have to go to places like those big wind turbines in Rhode, Florida, to find communities that do a better job than we do. So we're looking at issues of sustainability. We're trying to lower our carbon footprint, trying to be the carbon bank for the rest of the town. Then we have a town meeting form of government, a volunteer form of government. And when you think about it, Hadley's been around for more than 350 years, and all of the major decisions, all the key decisions made in town, having to do with financial management, having to do with educational policy, having to do with chief executive functions, having to do with regulatory compliance for wetlands, for zoning, etc. All of those are carried out by volunteers. You have some professionals to help you out, a chief of police and a fire chief. DPW director and so forth, but the rest is done by volunteers. And that has very good benefits for the town because it means that decisions are local, they're accountable, they're transparent, they're empowering. We have an empowered democracy, if you will, and it also means that there are many opportunities for anyone to get involved, and we'll be hitting that at the last slide, at even a relatively young age. So there are many opportunities to get involved. Hadley works because of its volunteers, and we need your participation. If I may have the next slide. We saw the credit rating, the next one. Okay, so what makes up the credit rating? First of all, we'll talk a little bit about the reserves. The stabilization, okay, so stabilization is the money that we've set aside in order to make sure that we have enough in reserves in case of an emergency, but also it helps build our credit rating. We have $2 million in reserves, and that represents 14.2% of our operating budget. The Massachusetts standard is 5%, so we exceed the Department of Revenue standard benchmark of 5%, and our own policy is 10%. We exceed that by an additional margin. So we have very healthy reserves that are available in case we need that, but it also tells the world that we have a strong financial position. Next slide, please. Free cash history. Free cash sounds great. The cash part is that it's actually cash. It's not promissory notes. It's not an IOU. It's not a letter of credit. And the free part is that it's free of encumbrances, and it's not been earmarked for some reason. So it's a technical term. Sounds great. Sounds better than what it actually is. But our free cash from year to year has ranged between a low of about $500,000 to $1.1 million. And this is a result of conservative budgeting. This money is reinvested back into the town, both in terms of building up other reserves or purchasing capital equipment or supporting operations where needed. Another thing that builds our good credit rating is our borrowing. This is our debt service per year, our debt and interest payment per year, expressed as a percentage of operating expenses. And you can see right about now it's about 6%. That's within an ideal range that creditors like to see. They like to see no less than 6% of debt service as a percentage of your operating budget, and no higher than 10% of debt service per operating budget. So too little debt means that you're not keeping up with your capital plan. It means that you're setting yourself up for a fall in the future. Too much debt obviously is a burden on the taxpayers, and shouldn't let it go higher than 10%. When I first started here, it was 14%, so we brought it down into the ideal range. The next one is our tax base. This is common for every Massachusetts town and city. Under Proposition 2.5, the tax increases by this formula here. You have the large section on the bottom, which is your levy limit from the prior year. That is your base for any fiscal year. The next one is the 2.5% increase that's allowed under Proposition 2.5. And then you can add to it what's called new growth. New growth is any new construction or remodeling that adds value to the town of Hadley. So kitchen renovations, new buildings, solar panels, solar farms that get put up. So any construction that requires a building permit of some kind builds that new growth. And then finally on top of it is debt exclusion, which is excluded debt and interest that you have approved for various projects, whether that be buses or trucks or buildings. So in Hadley, this is our valuation per classification. The Department of Revenue broadly classifies property into two categories. The bottom part is your residential agricultural section, and the top part is your commercial, industrial, and what's called personal property. That is that our valuation is somewhere between $900 million and $1 billion for the town of Hadley at this point. And it's, this is a very well-balanced valuation between the classes. So you have about 35% is in commercial, industrial, and personal property, and 65% is in residential and agricultural property. This balance really works for the town of Hadley. Houses consume a lot of services. Commercial properties consume fewer services, and we make money from that. And then open space and agricultural space consume almost nothing in the way of services. And even though they don't pay much in the way of taxes, they're not demanding much in the way of services. And again, just as in anything in life, balance is very important. This is a very good balance. Most other towns would love to have this kind of balance within the tax base. Next slide. And so the taxes that derive from that valuation are broken down into the five categories: residential, open space, commercial, industrial, and personal property. And again, you have that 65-35 split that shows up in revenue coming in to operate the budget. So this is where the money comes in, and these are the sources, rather, that generate the money that we use to run the budget. So about 69%, that's the real estate and the personal property combined, come in. Our state aid is somewhere around 11%, and all the other fees that we can collect, the dog licenses, the liquor licenses, the fines, the interest income, motor vehicle excise, all those 1,001 different categories, that represents about 20%. Obviously, if we can expand our motel meals tax, our motor vehicle revenue, our fees and assessments, that means that we have more money that doesn't have to rely upon the taxes. And then the final slide for me is, so strong financial management, a very well-balanced, stable tax valuation, and conservative budgeting represent results in a low tax rate. So there you see Hadley as being the lowest among all these communities that we survey. And you have to go to places like Monroe or Roe or Irving in order to find tax rates that are lower than that in the valley. And the tax bill that people pay, the average tax bill in 2013, is about $3,200, which is about 16% lower than the county average and about 30% lower than the statewide average. So I'm going to turn this over to the select board.
Thanks, David. So what we want to talk about now are some of the challenges facing Hadley. And again, put it in the context of there's an awful lot going well. But one of the things that's apparent right now is that we have a very small workforce to address public service delivery, something that we might also call bench strength. And what we mean by that is we have some very dedicated, very hardworking municipal employees who unfortunately are quite stressed when they want to take a vacation day or they call out sick, because we don't necessarily have people who are positioned to fill in adequately in their absence. It's nothing unusual with a small organization as part of the growing pains, but again, Hadley is, or has grown, and it's something that we need to address for a variety of reasons. Obviously, we want to take good care of our workforce, but we also want to make sure that they have time for adequate training. So it's very difficult not only to take a vacation day, but if push comes to shove and you need to keep things running smoothly and you're faced with, you know, the choice of doing that or going to a training program that could help advance your particular functional area in the town as a whole, unfortunately the day-to-day operations win. Barriers to productivity is something that came up loud and clear when the department heads did the SWOT analyses. Very obvious example is antiquated information technology. We've done a good job investing where we needed to over the years, but one of the areas of infrastructure that I think we've been remiss is in the area of information technology. For those of you who've been around for a while, you heard this discussion take place a few years ago when the schools came to town meeting looking for some funding to give a shot in the arm, so to speak, to the elementary school, which didn't have a network in place. What we didn't talk about that night was the fact that the rest of the town doesn't either. So here we are a few years later, and you know, our employees are having to share files very manually. We don't have appropriate backup systems. You know, information technology changes very, very quickly. And right now we can tell you that we're very much behind the eight ball. And we can, you know, I'm fairly certain that we could increase productivity and again, have a much happier workforce if we can invest in our technology systems. Decentralized decision making. That may sound a little bit confusing, but when you think about the form of government that David was talking about before, you have an elected select board. Every year there's an election, people are turning over. Same with the school committee, the planning board. And just the way that the Mass General Law is written with a town administrator position, we have all sorts of dotted lines and some confusion as to who's really responsible for making certain decisions. So in that sort of decentralized decision-making environment, you're at the mercy of when the boards meet. So our select board, I think over the past few years, has been meeting far more frequently because there's been so much to get done. But again, you're having to wait, you know, a week or 2 weeks sometimes to bring things in front of us for decisions to get made. So it's just a challenge. Lack of volunteers we talked about. Again, we rely so heavily on volunteers in town, and Hadley's no different than any other municipality, or quite frankly, you know, we hear this all across the country, that trying to get people to carve out some of their personal time and volunteer for municipal government activities is difficult. There's so many challenges we all face during the day, so many choices to make between family commitments, kids with sporting events, other personal interests. So, you know, we are suffering from having a lot of vacancies on our various committees, and that's something that we need to figure out how we can work on that and get seats in those chairs. Elements of zoning that restrict future new growth. Again, we have made some zoning decisions over the years that right now are perhaps prohibiting some types of development in town. Not saying it's wrong or right, but just a discussion that needs to be ongoing, certainly with our planning board and our the folks at our ZBA, our building inspector. This is something that has been discussed fairly frequently. We enjoy modest revenue growth, but we're keying in on the word modest. You know, David mentioned earlier, new growth in Hadley is a good thing, but it's a fairly fixed percentage. We're only looking at something less than 2% every year of new growth. So when you take Proposition 2.5, and then you think about that layered cake, if you will, that David showed earlier of where the tax base comes from, we're really not keeping pace with the demands of a continuous improvement theme, and quite frankly, in some cases, even just being able to keep delivery constant year after year. Unfunded mandates and escalating costs. This is something we all hear about. You know, the state comes up with good ideas, the federal government comes up with ideas, they just don't necessarily provide the funding. I think probably the most recent and obvious example of that being the new stormwater regulations. I'm not saying that they aren't with good cause, but the burden is being put back on the municipality and therefore the revenue generators, which are the taxpayers. So these are some of the challenges facing us right now. So if you look at how the general fund expenses are broken out, not surprisingly, you can see the largest slice of the pie is going to education, as it should be. Then you'll notice that there's this piece called unclassified. And unclassified is made up of state assessments and employee benefits. People are our most significant resource, but that means that people are also our most significant component of expense. So, but the pressures of keeping up with pay and the demands on employee benefit costs, which include things like OPEB, which we'll talk a little bit about later, but it's not just what they're paid today, but also medical plans, other benefits, and then retirement and post-retirement benefits as well. So there's a new growth trend we were talking about, and you can see there was a little bit of a blip in 2015, which was related to the solar, the advent of the solar pilot programs in town. So that's been a good thing. But again, look at the percentage there. It's a very, very small percent increase every year. So general government. General government, you can see, has been, you know, relatively consistent. In 2012, there's a little blip in the graph there, which is related to a bit of a harsh winter. And I think Gary Berg and the folks from the DPW and those charged with maintaining our buildings can tell you that we had to spend some money that year. So that's that slight variation. Otherwise, it's relatively constant. General government being basically town hall. You think about the functions that are performed at town hall. That's what we're talking about here. So I guess what we wanted to highlight tonight in terms of challenges, there's a tremendous amount of good work being done at our town hall. We have a lot of excellent, highly skilled elected officials as well as municipal employees doing good work day in and day out. But some of the functions that you might expect in an organization the size of Hadley need to be brought out. So for example, human resources. I challenge anybody in the audience who doesn't work for a municipal government to think about an organization with hundreds of employees, yet there's no human resources department per se. We have a very good treasurer's office, and Joan does a fantastic job dealing with employee benefits, but that's not the same as a human resource function. Somebody focused on job descriptions, you know, performance reviews, making sure that they're there when an employee has a problem, probably being the most important thing. So when there are human resource issues, those either filter to the department heads or they wind up in David Nixon's office. And when that happens, as you would imagine, they're time sensitive, they need to be dealt with immediately, which means other things are being put to the side. Information technology, I already mentioned. We don't have an information technology director, manager, whatever you want to call it. So we do outsource the technology function, but there's nobody really doing the overall care and feeding to make sure that we're keeping up with updates, looking to build a better mousetrap, etc. Purchasing is decentralized. So the school department does their purchasing, different town departments do their purchasing. We think that there's an opportunity to somehow look at centralizing that function and perhaps get a better bang for the buck through that type of centralized focus on purchasing and procurement. And probably the biggest challenge that we believe we face with the general government is management bandwidth. Again, we're staffed adequately to keep things operating on a day-to-day basis, but if there's a project that has to be done, there's not a lot of time in the day to make that happen. And again, people need to step aside from day-to-day operations to try to roll up their sleeves and get some think time to accomplish bigger tasks. Okay, so that's it for general government, and I'm going to turn it over to Joyce to talk about public safety.
Safety expenditures as percentage of total net operating expenditures. We have not really changed from 2010 until 2016, 1% bouncing from those dates forward. And most of those increases that you see there are from overtime statuses. We've started to level off again this year, thanks to our chiefs doing their job over there and trying to make things better and increasing staffing. And that's one of the things that we're looking at this year that was important for us to do. Oh, here we go. The public safety has challenges, of course. We have the displacement of the North Hadley fire station. With the sale of the North Hadley Hall, it does displace our fire department up there. And I'm not sure even if it's a sale at this point, but or a tear down, one of the two. Those are two of the things that are on the town meeting floor for fall town meeting. I'm already jumping to spring. Great. It's been so warm. So we have a new fire truck that's coming. We have no place to put it. It's not large enough up in North Hadley and moving equipment around. So we still need to make room for this new truck that's coming in October, November, which will be here. We have a volunteer fire force. If you think about the demographics of our town, we stretch from South Hadley, Amherst, and to Sunderland. And going all the way to Sunderland, we have found, and our chief, Spank and Abel, has found that the response time is certainly much better when you have a fire station in North Hadley to reach the people up in Shattuck Road and in that area, or running to the Sunderland line on Route 47. So, of course, the people in North Hadley really feel, and I think everybody should feel, that some type of substation is necessary for our North Hadley residents. So that's one of the things that's on the table at this point. We also have, we're looking at the adequacy of the police department. We had a report done, I say 10 years now, we're probably out even longer than that, of increasing our police department. And we're just starting to do that. We're changing things around. We've added more sergeants. We're adding more full-time people, which does eliminate using part-time or special people, or when there's call-outs and things of that nature, that we are at least have people to fill those spots and come in without doing the overtime. And that's why you see a better balance in the spikes in the deficits. The volunteer fire force, we only have two full-time. We have a chief and we have a lieutenant. All the rest is staffed by volunteer firefighters. So in order to carry out and cover our town 24/7, some days it's a challenge because we're all responding to each call that comes in. You don't know what you're going to get when you get a call. You know, they say it's a motor vehicle accident. It could be anything. It could be medical that caused that motor vehicle accident. So we are responding to all the accidents that are occurring, and the police also go. So, you know, it ties up a good amount of people. So a lot of other things don't get done because our chief goes out and he goes to the response to these things, as does the lieutenant, you know, whatever is necessary to cover that. Years ago, people would ring a bell and off people would go from their farms and their jobs and they would just go, well, that can't happen anymore. So you have to have people that are trained. It costs money to train. They have training sessions. They're mandated to do this, and that's part of what we have to do as a part of our safety infrastructure. Overtime and burnout, that is, as you see, we have limited sources, as in all due departments. If somebody is sick, it's hard for everybody to fill in and take notice of what happens. So when a policeman calls out, I mean, you can get sick, that happens. You have to backfill, and you know there's a rotating of. You want me to hurry up?
No.
Oh, okay. Just get a look. So you have to fill those, you know, spots. You can't not fill them. You have to take care of what's going on in town here. We have a backup. We don't have a backup dispatch center if the North Hadley Hall goes. There is one there, but it's really not functionable. So that again is another reason to have another substation in North Hadley. The facilities that we have, North Hadley, which is not going to be there, as I can see. And then we have our fire station, police station complex on East Street. That's already over 20 years old. And now we're always already having to do repairs on that. You have to do repairs to upkeep on your buildings. We've outgrown it as a fire department. It's not suitable or doesn't meet our needs for the trucks that we have there. The police department itself is inadequate where the sallies are, and all of that needs to be thought about and redone. We need to, you know, this was a time of the year, this year, that we were thinking about what we need to do for our police and fire. We were putting that on the list of to-do things. So that's our challenges on the public safety complex. Education. Education. Who would, and this is our superintendent.
just going to let the schools open up their presentation. They have a separate PowerPoint.
I was just saying nice job, Joyce. I was just saying nice job.
Thank you.
No?
Thank you. I didn't know I was supposed to do like Molly.
You just minimize it? So this is my fault because I disabled the mouse pad and I didn't mean to. So just getting a little bit more creative in how we're using this.
So, good evening, everyone. My name is Annie McKenzie, and I'm the superintendent of schools. I hope you can all hear me. Can you hear me okay? Thank you. Well, that's helpful. Normally, I say that to students, and they nod like, yes, we can hear you, because we don't really, it doesn't matter if we do or don't. So, thank you so much for coming out tonight and listening to us talk a little bit about each department in town, the strengths that we have, and some of the challenges that we're facing. I will try to be succinct and to the point. My purpose is to tell you a little bit about who we are, the two schools in town, the students whom we serve, the adults who serve them well, just some basic facts about our schools, and then tell you what we aspire to, what's our vision, what's our mission, how we allocate resources in an attempt to ensure that we realize our vision, the trends that we monitor to make sure that our resource allocation strategy is working effectively and what adjustments we might need to make, some of the challenges that we face and how those challenges inform what we perceive to be the potential for a what we would call a structural revenue deficit to support schools in the upcoming years. So first of all, who we are, Hadley Public Schools. We have two school buildings in town, if you're not familiar with that. We serve children in preschool through grade 12, and for some students, we serve them all the way to the age of 22, depending on their needs. At Hadley Elementary School, we have 277 students currently enrolled in kindergarten through sixth grade, and about 33 students enrolled in our preschool program. We're really proud of the fact that we invest heavily in our students in both of our schools. We care deeply about the whole child. We want to make sure that we're meeting the needs of our children, not just academically, preparing them for from elementary school to middle school, high school, and college, but also that we are supporting their social and emotional needs. To that end, in Hadley Elementary, over the last 2 years, we've invested heavily in a program called Positive Behavioral Interventions and Supports. It's a lot of words to say that we recognize that we don't just learn ABCs and mathematics in school, but we learn a lot about interpersonal skills, getting along with others, and the skills that we need, what the marketplace calls soft skills, the skills that we need to be successful in life. So positive behavioral interventions and supports means that the adults work with children to ensure that kids are developing not only academically, but that we're supporting them behaviorally, socially, and emotionally. We also have individualized interventions for children at the elementary school. And what we're seeing as a result of that, so that means we assess children frequently, particularly in the areas of literacy and mathematics. We want to make sure that if we see a student struggling, that we intervene as quickly as possible. That is a labor-intensive enterprise. It requires very low student-to-staff ratios, but we think it is extremely important. What we believe is that if we don't take the time to intervene early, that students will fall behind and that the consequences of falling behind are significant. And they're not just significant to school performance, certainly that matters to me, and it matters to taxpayers in the town, but those consequences are incredibly significant to the child who might find him or herself behind academically. At Hopkins Academy, we continue our commitment to intervening and working with each individual student. We want every single child to be seen, known, and heard, and we want to make sure that every child is connected to an adult in the building. We have a wide range of curricular programs that give students all kinds of opportunities to demonstrate their strengths and pursue their interests, and in addition to that, we have a wide range of extracurricular activities. We have a strong athletics program. We have over 50% of our students participating in that. We know that students who participate in extracurricular activities have much better academic and social outcomes. Pardon me, that'll look good on camera. That was a bug, not just an odd thing that I'm doing, some pantomime thing for you. So we know that students who are participating in extracurricular activities are typically happier at school, they're better organized, and they have better outcomes. And I just want to say our students first and athletes second, and that is demonstrated by the fact that last year our students won the Sportsmanship Award for our entire district, so it speaks a great deal to the character of the children at Hopkins Academy. We know that the percentage of students enrolled in advanced coursework at Hopkins exceeds the state average. The percentage of students enrolling in post-secondary upon exiting high school exceeds the state average. And the percentage of students obtaining a degree, their first degree, in a timely fashion also exceeds the state average. We're extremely proud of that. So where we want to go, thank you. And you can bring in that and the next one. So this is our mission. We feel responsible if we are going to request resources from the town that we tell you what our goal is, what we intend to achieve by investing your resources. So clearly, we believe that if we have strong schools, we will have a healthy community and a healthy local economy. And we are committed to providing for every student a safe and supportive environment that fosters cooperation, critical thinking, creativity, integrity, and a love of learning. And that comes from a lot of interaction with adults. So how do we allocate resources to achieve this mission? Similar to what you've heard other people say, I apologize that it's hard to read with the colors, but the largest part of this pie, the red, are salaries. It's about 66% of our budget, something that you saw mirrored also on the town side. And I'll say again, our business is investing in people, young people, and helping them to succeed. And we believe that in order to invest in young people, we need to invest in the adults who serve those young people. And so that's our primary expenditure category. Thank you. Our revenue sources. We are supported primarily by local contributions, so that means money that comes directly from the town. We appreciate that very much. Thank you. I will have you know, and I'll reference a research paper at the very end of this, but there's a gentleman from the University of Delaware whose last name is McKenzie, no relation. I'm sure he's a lot smarter than I am. He wrote a paper, it's been a while now. His data is from about 2003 and 2004 when he did his analysis of property taxes. But what he found was that the strongest schools and the most economically healthy communities, but the strongest schools were those schools that were supported mostly by local funding in the mix of state, federal, and local. So thank you for the investment in your schools, and I can also tell you as taxpayers and property owners, for those of you who are property owners, that it's a good investment to make. Our next slide, thank you. So some trends, you can pull up the next one. Let's start with one more, just our in number. I'm proud to say that you can see these are the students who choose our public school district, although they reside in another town. So you see that number is on the upswing. We're glad. We feel as though our programs and our people, are attracting children into this district. On the out, you can see the students who are electing to go to other districts. We're trying to retain as many as we can and bring them back, and you can see we're going in the right direction. That's a gap you want to see. We almost are over 2-to-1 in terms of students coming in as opposed to students exiting. You can go ahead. This is a challenge. We support the right of every parent to choose whatever educational option they feel is most appropriate for their child. So I have no personal bone of contention with charter schools. I do struggle a bit with the formula, and you'll see how the funding formula for charters plays out for local public schools. So what's important is to see we have 39 students. We started at just over 21. If you're wondering what a 0.1 student looks like, is that a particularly diminutive and quiet student? No, it isn't. They do the funding based on pro rata, so monthly. When a student enrolls is how they make this determination. We can go to the next slide. Another trend that we pay attention to is the cost of providing students with the educational options that they are entitled to under federal law. So that means if a student who has special needs requires a placement out of our district, a private placement out of our district, it is a federal responsibility of the town to fund that placement. And we've seen an escalation, not so much in the number of students requiring the service, but in the severity of need and the corresponding cost for providing that service. We also have seen an increase in the cost of vocational education, again, something that children are entitled to under Chapter 74, the Perkins Act, it's a federal law and a state law. So we've seen an increase in cost and in interest for vocational education. You can go to the next slide. Grant funding. So one of the things that you may have noticed on the town slides is it appears as though there's a spike at one point. And it looks like, why all of a sudden is the school budget a greater percentage of the total operating budget for the town? And what this slide, not as visibly as I would like, but what it shows you is in 2013, the blue bar at the bottom refers to entitlement grants. So those are grants that you don't apply for. You get those grants based on the students who are enrolled and the kind of programming that they need. It's always a challenge for a small school district to capture entitlement monies because we don't have large populations of students who usually receive entitlement funding, English language learners, homeless, low income, not a huge percentage, so it's harder to get these monies. In 2013, our entitlement grant funding was just over $465,000. And in 2017, it's $365,000, I'll round up. So it's about $100,000 less. But when that grant funding goes away, and some of the spikes we saw had to do with an intense infusion of funding that happened around in the wake of the 2008 crash. There was something in education called Race to the Top funding that became available to us, where the federal government was trying to ensure that school districts didn't just completely fall apart. And when that money went away, that money was funding programs, not brand new and different programs, it was just keeping us alive. And so you see the entitlement funding goes down, but we still have to maintain. And that means that the town contribution increases at a greater percentage than the total operating expenses for the school. I will point out, although it's hard to see, discretionary are the grants that we compete for. Those have increased. In 2013, they were about $49,000, and now they're up to $67,200. So we're getting competitive grants. Let me go to the next slide. Thank you. All right, so we can pull this in. One more. We'll start with the first line. Charter school tuitions. So the tuitions that we're paying for those 39 students in the aggregate, we estimate that in FY17, based on what's called a cherry sheet from the governor's office, so a budget sheet from the governor's office, it's every time I get it, it's white. I don't know why they call it a cherry sheet. Maybe Molly could answer that for me one day. Used to be red? Thank you. The charter school tuitions, we estimate that they'll be just over $600,000. Actually, the slide isn't showing this correctly because the FY17 amount is at about $622,000 is what we're estimating that we'll be paying out in charter school tuitions. Excuse me, I take that back. I just changed up my school choice in charter school. Charter school tuitions we estimate will just be over $580,000. That's what we'll pay for those 39 children to go to charter schools, because an individual charter school tuition, it's a fairly complex formula, but it ranges. Some schools we pay $14,400 per student, some we pay $15,000, in one case we pay almost $21,000 per student. We can go to the next line. Our school choice receiving, what we pay out when children leave in school choice, the school choice based formula is about $5,000 per pupil. So roughly, we expect to pay out just over $250,000, I believe, in FY17. And our last line, what we expect to take in for school choice is the $622,000. But I want you to look at the fact that for 104 students, we'll take in $622,000 under the current funding formula. And we will pay almost $581,000 to send out 39. There appears to be a challenge for us in the charter choice funding formula as it currently exists. We can move on to the next slide. So what happens? And we can bring the line in. So this blue line estimates how much school choice we would use. And this assumes a budget that is growing, expenses growing at roughly 3% annually. Let me be very clear that when you're projecting budgets, it's a difficult thing to do, it's tricky, and it's really hard to be accurate. But what we did is we looked at actual expenditures in our most expensive and volatile categories, transportation, special education, personnel, which isn't volatile, but the largest part of our budget. We looked at the average increase over the last 5 years, and then we applied that going forward. We similarly assumed that town contribution would match our increases. We don't know that to be true, but those are the assumptions that we made. We assumed that grants would increase at 2.25% annually. That's a guess. We have no idea what the grant landscape will look like. And so those are the amount of school choice dollars we would need. The next line will show you, based on where our school choice balance will be, because we need those dollars, but based on what we get coming in for school choice versus what we expend, not so much in school choice going out, because we have a net gain of almost $317,000 projected in FY17 if you just look at choice. But when you factor in that $581,000 from charter school and you extrapolate that over several years, you end up with a deficit. And so school choice, on this assumption, by FY22, is almost in the hole by $300,000. We can go to the next slide. So for us, we say, holy guacamole, that might be a problem. And we think that it might be time for folks to think about what would a comprehensive revenue strategy look like that could help us to avoid what we see as a potential structural revenue deficit based on some of the slides that you just saw. Because we want to make sure those slides just assume level services. We haven't added programs. We haven't done major enhancements. We're just keeping pace with what we currently have. So some concluding thoughts. I mentioned a study that was done by Professor McKenzie at the University of Delaware. Again, I don't know him. He's not, doesn't know that I'm talking about him. Now, he found that school system quality, and this should not surprise anybody here, but that it is certainly correlated with higher property values. All of our residents benefit from strong schools, that there's a direct positive correlation between school taxes and property values. So when local taxes go towards schools, it does benefit property values. And that school quality and local property values are both enhanced by increased local funding of public schools. And if you're interested in the study, I'm happy to give you a copy of it, and the source is also listed in your handouts. So thank you for paying attention. I appreciate your time tonight. Do you want me to do this now? We're going to hold questions to the end, Mark. Okay. So we just need to switch back to the other presentation.
Public Works, there we are. I'd like to echo everybody's sentiment with thanks for coming this evening. Your contribution's going to mean a lot to us. The first slide here shows the public works expenditures, and it shows that the expense in between 2010 and 2016 hasn't variated. There's no variation, been less than 1%. You can see we're at 575 in 2010, and in 2016 we're at about 6.25%. So it's only about 0.5% there, with one spike in the number, which came, I think, as we had said earlier, to the fact that there was a snowy winter that was involved with that. Next slide, please. I'm a glass half full kind of guy, and I know we're talking about challenges tonight, but with our DPW, I'd kind of like to point out a couple of the things that, you know, that we're really, really proud of. And first of all, it is the DPW. I'd like to say thank you to Mike Klimoski, who retired this year. He worked a lot of years for us, and we owe a lot of our wonderful roads and our DPW structure to him. Thanks, Mike. We're thinking of you tonight. I'd like to thank the taxpayers, and I know the DPW would like to thank the taxpayers for a lot of the support that we've gotten in the last few years. We have a lot of new equipment on the road. We have a new backhoe, and those are things that we've been striving to get for a long time. So I know they wanted to say thank you for your support as well tonight. I'd like to say thank you to DPW, the workers themselves. I think everybody knows here that we have some of the best roads in the county, if not the best roads. As everybody travels them in the wintertime especially, I think everybody gets comments about how well the roads are done in Hadley, and I'd like to thank the DPW workers for that as well. I'd like to thank Marla Warner, who's been with us now 6 months, whose leadership and tutelage is going to bring us to the 21st generation, or generation, huh? 21st century with some of the modernizations that's going to be going on with the DPW, and make it a little easier for everybody to communicate with us. But we do have challenges. We have an aging infrastructure. Some of our piping that we have is 100 years old. Just like every other community in Western Massachusetts, we don't own this by ourselves. Everybody's like that. We do a great job of keeping up with breaks as they happen, and they're not that bad for us along the way. Our bench strength in key positions. Over the last few years, we've lost the Mike Klimoskis, we've lost Gus, we've lost Leon, we've lost, you know, 100 years of people who worked in our DPW. And that's hard to fill and backfill. So we understand that, and we want to keep the quality of work up to what it is and what you're used to. So we need to make sure that we train the people along the way to get them up to the strength that we're looking for. Our work order system, Marlo's just recently put in a work order system. So we're getting phone calls from people, a work order is being generated. We're writing down what's being done, when it's being done, where it's being done. So in the future, if we have any future concerns regarding those things, we'll be able to reference it. That's a long way from go ask Michael. I know he'd remember that. Maintenance program for equipment, we've upgraded that as well. As Molly had said a little while ago, the new stormwater mandate and impacts, the state, or the EPA has come to the town of Hadley, as well as a lot of towns in Hampshire County, and said that the stormwater that is going into the storm drains and eventually ending up in the Connecticut River is raising a lot of havoc down in the Sound in New York. So what we need to do is clean that up a little bit. So they're asking each one of the communities, and this is an unfunded mandate, to initiate understanding where the water's coming from, what the water's made up of, and to mitigate that water so what's going out there has the least amount of nasties that we possibly can do. Again, it's an unfunded mandate. It's going to cost us $390,000 over the next 5 years. We've applied for an SRF grant. We've spoken to consultants regarding taking care of this for us. But again, it's just another unfunded mandate that we need to address. And our facilities, we're working out of a couple of trailers down at the DPW building. They do the best they can. It's not that bad, but it is a trailer. So they've listed the fact that they'd like to, in some way, bring that up to the 21st century, too, in the near future. So we're going to be talking a little bit about that down the line. Again, it's not something that we're here to discuss tonight, and we're doing the best we can with what we have, and I thank them for their good work.
Areas to get through, and then we'll be turning it over for questions. Human services. Human services, think about the Council on Aging, thinking about veterans' benefits. The good news is that we're doing a really good job with outreach, but with outreach also comes cost. So when we think about the Council on Aging, some of the issues that were identified in the SWOT analysis, this has nothing to do with Hadley, this is just a demographic that's out there. I mean, the population served is growing. Baby boomers are becoming seniors, and there's a huge wave coming right along here. It's not going to stop anytime soon, which means that, the population that needs to be served is growing. Facilities, there's not an awful lot to say about the facilities. If anybody has been in the current Council on Aging rooms at the old Hooker School, it's not necessarily a welcoming place. I think that some people have developed a fondness for it, but there's no question that things need to change there. So again, not for specific discussion tonight, but there is an article at town meeting. The seniors are actively working and lobbying for the opportunity to have an upgraded, newer facility. The other issue that was raised with the Council on Aging is there's a very heavy reliance on volunteers. And again, there's a dearth of volunteers. And what that means is sometimes there aren't people available to drive the bus or to provide services to seniors that they've come to rely upon. So we're hoping to do something about that, get more people involved. Veteran services. A couple of years back, we made a change, and we actually regionalized that with the city of Northampton, is now providing the leadership for the veteran service outreach. Again, it's been very successful. What that means is that the number of veterans being served has grown tremendously. However, that does come at a financial cost. So never do we want to be in a position where the budget is driving services to our veterans.
Donald?
That's only for TV.
He said it's.
I'll pass this down to you.
It's live on TV.
Okay, then I'll take that. I probably don't mean it. That's a standing joke. Everybody says I don't need a mic, anyways. Okay, my allotted time is to talk about the library and park and recreation. Prior to doing that, I'm going to take a couple of minutes to talk about the bigger picture, which is going to entail the federal government and state government a little bit. But before I get into that, I would like to explain how we left last year's town meeting with $2.39. And a lot of kudos go to our department heads and our collection office. Today we have $583 in free cash again, which is phenomenal. I never thought it would raise to that. Our collections normally come in about $112,000 that we don't collect. With aggressive collection this year, it came in at 75, and she's continued to work at it and her assistant, and right now it's down to about 30K going into tax title, which is phenomenal. So thank you to collection agency, I appreciate it. Now, just a little bit about federal government. As you know, the federal government is in dire shape right now. If you follow the periodicals and listen to the budgets that they have, right now our children and grandchildren are going to inherit a deficit of $19.3 million. So I'm not going to speak any more about the federal government. I think everybody knows what shape they're in. But more important to me right now is this is the Beacon. It's a publication by the Mass Municipal Association, and it comes out monthly. And the front page says, Revenue Sump Clouds Budget Picture. What's happening in the state legislature now? They're having a forum today, just like we are, trying to sort out this mess of the 2016 budget and finalize it for the middle of October. Current figures show a growth of only about 2.2% in total collections in the first 6 months, or the first two quarters of revenues. that means a deficit of approximately $500 million below the projected $25.4 billion. There's a couple outstanding things there that remain. Some of our people are involved with the Community Preservation Trust Fund. That is funded through the surplus of the stabilization money, and 10% of it goes towards that fund, up to $10 million. So that's in jeopardy. And right now, we're receiving 39% back for every dollar that we put into the Community Preservation Act. Two good things that happened in the budget, $3.7 million on the circuit breaker. They put it back in the legislature, and this is for the funding of special needs students. Say if we have a special needs student move into our town or two, it could cost us $100,000. So we're allotted extra money with this circuit breaker account, and our school committee handles that account accordingly. The second thing they put back in was $220,000 in secondary aid to libraries, which is good because those are the areas that get cut first. Same in Hadley, Park and Rec, and libraries. They always take the brunt of when they have to stack up against fire and police and education. So I was glad that went back in. Okay, now let me get to my slide here that I'm supposed to be talking about. As you can see with the slide, over the beginning, it was about back in 2014, there was a budget of approximately $185,439, which the voters actually raised to $201,000. I'm going to round these off. $215,000, $191,000 to $200,000, and $216,000 presently is $203,000, which is a level funded budget. The curve, if you look at it, would be above, right now, somewhere a little below 1.75%. We're at a low of 1.4% back in 2011. And this is comprised of our total budget. So park and libraries are about 1.8% of our total budget. That's what that chart means. We can go to challenges. Next slide. I'm really not going to speak about the presentation of the new library and that article that's going to be forthcoming in Town Warrant Forum about all the town articles. So I'm going to just let that go. Our library does need help. It's not handicap accessible in many areas. They are growing in leaps and bounds. So that's something that will be discussed on our town warrant articles. And Park and Rec, they're going to have to be relocated because North Hadley Hall is being shut down. And on September 19th, there is a ZBA hearing to find out what the direction of North Hadley Hall and a possible future North Hadley sub-fire station. So it's very important, if you have any interest in that, to please attend that ZBA hearing. Closing down North Hadley Hall is going to result in about $20,000 in savings. The heating bill there is atrocious, just for that alone. The present fire station has its own heating system. We have $92,000 left in Russell School and Town Hall. Actually, it comes to about, I think, $130,000. That money could be used to build out North Hadley Fire Station. All it needs to do is be built out about 6 feet. And then the truck that's coming from Center Station could be parked in there for the duration till everything is figured out what's going to happen, if there is a substation or not. And that could be accomplished for less than $10,000. If we went out to rent an area for someone, we had figures as high as $5,000 to rent a month. So with the loss of North Hadley Hall, the Park and Rec is sort of a little turmoil, but they will have the field temporarily behind, depending on what happens with Council on Aging and their new building proposal. But North, the Park and Rec is also working in conjunction with the schools, trying to build new ball fields behind Hopkins Academy, which CPA money has been proposed there. They're doing a feasibility study on it now. They were granted that money and looking for money in the future to that, to accomplish that. There'll be community fields, so it could be used by all people in the town department, but the custodial person for that wouldn't necessarily be the schools because they have the first priority there. Secondly, Zadurka Park. I don't know if many people know about that. That's the old stump dump on Huntington Road. There was an old tennis court there. The money has been voted at last town meeting to turn that whole place into a park. Everybody rides by it and they think it's very small, but there's 6.3 acres there. And they propose a band shell, a small pavilion, rose garden, butterfly garden, some little fields for youngsters. And I even heard for the grandfathers, when they bring their youngsters there, there may even be a putting green. So that's a good thing. So, and I think that pretty much wraps up the library and the recreation departments. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Donald. So the last slide, I think, is, yep, and actually we talked about employee benefits already, so we can skip to opportunities, and then we're going to turn it over to questions. So just want to point out, I mean, over the past few years, when you think about the changes that the town has seen, recent leadership hires, I mean, we have a new police chief, we have a new fire chief, DPW director, Council on Aging director, library director, and a new superintendent of schools. And it's a pretty significant change in the leadership team, and with that comes tremendous opportunity. We also signed something called the Commonwealth Compact. It's an initiative by Governor Baker and his team to reach out to municipalities to help us with some of the daily challenges. Particularly, we've signed up for work on figuring out the best financial management structure for the town. And we're working on
IT.
And information technology infusion as well. And then the school department has an initiative underway with them. So the prospect for grant monies, we're hoping it will start to improve when we can apply more attention to it. And another thing that's pretty critical is that we seem to have a renewed interest in collaboration, collaboration mindset. There's a tremendous amount of cooperation happening between town departments, between our town and other towns. And it's a very good thing, and it's necessary when resources are limited, and it's probably going to achieve a better end result for all of us. So, kind of in closing for us, the last thing we wanted to talk about is just ask you for help. What can you do to help? First and foremost, be informed. Make sure that when you're voting, you have all of the facts, and not just, you know, a few sound bites that might happen. And we recognize that we're a part of that, making sure we get better information out to everybody to help with that process. Join a committee. We have several openings on town committees. I think that they're advertised on HPAT, and certainly the list is available at the Selectman's office at Town Hall and the Clerk's office. Volunteer in any way that you can. Even a few hours here and there can go a long way, especially when we're talking about the Council on Aging. Come to town meeting and vote. I mean, we only have, you know, about 150 people that show up. Sometimes it's really exciting. We might get 350, but that's a small percentage of the voters in this town. Support your municipal employees and, if I may boldly say, your elected and appointed officials. We're trying our best. I mean, I think everybody wakes up in the morning wanting to do best by the town. Sometimes we fail, sometimes we fail miserably, but for the most part, things get done and they get done pretty well. So a pat on the back and a thank you, particularly to your municipal workers, goes a very long way to making the day go by faster and better. And provide constructive input. We are interested in hearing input, which is going to be where we go next. We want to make sure that people are providing feedback. We just ask that it be done in a respectful manner, but feedback is welcome, both positive and negative. So I think that's it for us, and with that, we wanted to open it up to questions. David, do you want to take the microphone for this portion?
That's what you call passing the buck.
Are there any questions that on any part of this? Mr. Kopacki? And there is a microphone there that we'll ask you to speak to.
No. No.
Oh. I was just wondering, as a select board, what do you think the threshold for the average household is that will tolerate a tax increase of $100, $500, $1,000? Because if you look at the planned budget increases, looking at $6 million each of the next consecutive 5 years, we're currently at around $19 million. So you're going up to $25 million next year if everything passes. What is that in terms of tax increase for an average household?
I think one thing I'd like to do is to clarify, I understand the question you asked. What you're asking is, if in fact everybody's wish list passed, what would the tax increase be? I think what I'd like to say is that when we first started talking here, we made it clear that we recognize that we can't possibly overnight get where we need to be. And that may involve some revenue increases, but it may also involve some tough look at expenses and the manner in which we're delivering our expenses. So we don't really have a budget right now. We haven't done the budget for the next fiscal year that reflects that thinking. So.
What do you think the threshold will be that the average taxpayer will be willing to?
To absorb?
To absorb it and having it passed out.
That's an interesting question.
I have an answer.
I think the question asks us to make a guess without hearing back from the people who are here. And so we may be able to answer that question a little bit better in a few minutes, but I think the answer that you would get right now would simply be a guess.
It would be a guess. I'm not asking you to ponder, but I'm also saying the slice of the population that's here does not reflect the entire town.
No, and I don't think so either. I think it's going to come to a decision. You know how things go at town meeting? Everybody can pass everything. But when it comes to going to the polls and increasing your taxes, that's where they draw the line, and that's where they decide where they want to do and how much they want to increase their taxes at this point. Not everybody can afford to do everything all at once, and I think it's going to be a conscious vote at the polls, not at town meeting. You can do all your presentation at town meeting, and it can all pass with all of the articles that are on there, but actually when you have to go and do a debt exclusion, that's where it is. And we can't possibly answer that at this point. You know that, Mark.
And you know, historically, that's what happens. It gets passed at town hall.
Absolutely.
And then the doors of the ballot, all that.
Yes.
I guess I'm one of your two ambitions.
No, I think when we have that direction, when people hear the presentations at town meeting, and then they will go to the polls and they'll vote their conscience of where they want to increase their taxes, whether it be infrastructure, school, park and rec, library, senior center. There are so many things on the agenda right now that they're really going to have to take a look at everything.
Oh, I don't care. Hang me. Yeah.
I guess, Mark, I'm going to answer your question from something that happened 20 years ago, believe it or not. We needed a new elementary school. We needed a new safety complex. Whoever thought the townspeople would vote $8 million to accomplish this? Well, let me finish. The the interest rate was enviable as it is today. Our interest rate was somewhere probably around 3%. We went out to borrow short-term notes a month ago, and $347,000, we got it for 0.74%, three-quarters of a percent. Our tax rate is very enviable. There is room for increases if the people choose to do it. It's going to be our responsibility as elected officials to set the priority and order how we think this can happen. We're not talking about everything happening in 1 year. We're probably talking somewhere between 5 to 7 years where everything gets blended in. And what is on top priority one by the building committee is the sub-fire station, and then they go to the Council on Aging, and then probably the library. But depending on the funding mechanism, maybe the library has to be moved up because we've probably already spent $100,000 trying to get to the level where they are today, and it would be wasted money. So that's all food for thought for all of us. And hopefully on the Warren articles, just like tonight's forum, we'll be able to lay down a game plan for everybody to analyze and question us about, and maybe we could work it out and stop the fighting between five different departments wanting new buildings all at once. That was the same thing that happened 20 years ago between the school and the safety complex. We as elected officials are trying to end that and try to pacify everybody, but we don't know if it's feasibly possible yet, Mark. We haven't got all the answers yet.
Temper your optimism.
I totally agree with Mark. And as every article goes through, the taxpayers, before they get to a ballot question, should know exactly what it's going to cost them on our tax rate. So, say the first articles, you lump all this stuff together, whether it's DPW, whether it's police, you can separate that. If this passes, this is what's going to affect the total up to that point. And to say, vote for all this, well, we'll unscramble it later at election. I think that's absolutely stupid. You should be doing things and advise people as they go. You pay as you go, not put it on your credit card and worry about later and try to figure it out at home. You should have that answer right at that town meeting.
I think you misunderstood me. I said we'll probably have these answers for
not
the
probably.
Town meeting warrant article discussion.
It shouldn't be probably.
We're still pulling
it should
everything
be.
Together, Mr. Michkowski. It's just, not easy.
Yeah, just to clarify, so, and we'll mention this again at the end, but we do have a special meeting scheduled this year, again, in the continuous improvement theme, specifically to address all of the warrant articles. We're holding it 1 week prior to the town meeting. The reason we're holding it that proximate to town meeting is to allow the greatest opportunity for the most and best information possible for everybody walking in. So at that meeting, exactly the information Mr. Michkowski is looking for and what Donald spoke about earlier will be available to the voters. Suzanne?
Asking for clarification on a couple of points that the school department made. Seeing as how the Council on Aging is less than 1% of the town budget, you gave some figures on the elementary school enrollment as 255.
277.
Thank you.
277.
And the high school?
In kindergarten through grade 6, with an additional 33 students in the preschool program. Sorry, Richard, do you need me to pick up a microphone? And at the Hopkins Academy, our enrollment at Hopkins Academy, 273 students. That was on September 6th. Enrollment is not certified. Sorry, thank you. Enrollment is certified by the department on October 1st. So those are official numbers that will drive the budget until October 1st, and then those enrollment numbers drive our allocation for fiscal year 18.
Okay. So according to my figures from 2014 from the Donahue Institute, we currently have 905 more seniors in Hadley than there are children enrolled in schools. And my combined budget with the town at $80,000 and my $12,501 from the state that runs our Council on Aging. We spend $51 a senior in this town with 905 more seniors in school. Apples and oranges for what it costs, so I'm not passing judgment on what it costs to educate. That's difficult, apples and oranges. But in your pie chart, it also had 12% other. Can you tell us what that other spending was?
Sure. So our biggest drivers when we're looking at, sorry, Richard. So our biggest drivers, I wish I had this, the chart up for you all again. But our biggest drivers are personnel. We have tuitions, instructional materials, special education, maintenance, and utilities. So other expenses that might be included in that could also include things in our budget, such as transportation costs, which you don't see listed on the pie and allocated out separately. So transportation costs for vocational, regular education, and special education. Additional costs could come in the form of contract obligations for professional development for educators. That's something that can be in a contract. Additional other costs may include, so textbooks and materials are listed, but supplies, paper, and things of that nature may also be a part of it.
Thank you for that. And I just, I have one comment to make. I have a different take on how the departments get along. I sat in the January 13th meeting here where every department gave a presentation on what they do, how they do it, where they do it, what the future projections are regarding all of those variables. And I walked out of here feeling like we're not alone in our struggles, that every department has their own struggles, and that Hadley has a lot of work to do. But the one thing I want to stress that didn't get into the paper that I'd like to say publicly is I have tremendous respect for the committed people that work for this town and how they do their job and how well they get along. I've worked for municipalities before. I get along superbly with everybody. We collaborate on everything, and I couldn't ask for a better group of people to work with. And I think I agree with Joyce insofar as we're not fighting for these funds. We know there's an opportunity to reinvest into the town. And so it's our obligation to advocate for our piece of the town that we care about, and we are happy to let the voters make that decision without fighting and arguing for those dollars. It's the voters, but we're doing our jobs because we care, and I just want to say I have utmost respect for everybody that works for this town.
Thank you.
I understand that this is the beginning of a process, or?
Oh, give him the mic.
We'll repeat the question. Sure. Go ahead, we'll repeat.
He's making a statement.
Is this on?
It's only live for TV.
Oh.
So you could use the other mic if you choose.
Come on up.
I understand that this is part of a process. Not the beginning, but the continuation of the process, and that there's a lot more to go. I'm about to be retired. I don't mind paying more taxes any more than anybody else, but I urge you to be ambitious and figure out what needs to be done and put costs on it and let the voters decide. Because if you decide not to offer an option, you won't get it.
Thank you.
David, could I answer that a little bit, please? I think it enters into another subject matter that's very important. You know, we haven't really spoke tonight about unfunded liabilities, which is health insurance for our retirees and things of that sort. Just some of the headlines, OPEB reform must be, it must be its top priority. The city of Springfield, pension liability, a time bomb. You know, I would ask our treasurer, she knows a lot about this, if she doesn't mind, just to get up and speak a few words about OPEB. I know we're putting $261,000 towards it, hopefully this year, to offset the payment because it affects our borrowing with Standard & Poor's if we don't. And there's $46 billion in Massachusetts, cities and towns that are unfunded. And it's really a big liability for the whole state. It's coming now to a head. And it's the same thing in federal government, too.
I think Linda and I are going to tag team on this one because we've been working in partnership to make this this unfunded liability challenge go away. Linda, did you want to speak or should I speak first?
Is this one up?
No, that's for TV only. This one's for the audience.
The amount we have now, this is really only just started about 5 years ago. We have now, as of the audit for 15, we had $264,000 in there. With our contribution this last year, we have over $500,000 in the OPEB. This is something we have to continue to contribute to every year. It's a budget item. We're trying to work it in so it's a budget item and not competing with other budgets and not competing with capital, but it's just something to keep in mind. Along with our other benefits, that we have to keep up our obligations that are not as visible, and it's harder to do that. That's a minimum contribution that we'll be making of the 250 this year. We ought to be doing more than that, but if we can hold on that, we're going to be in pretty good shape. The problem is if we walk away from it and say, well, we have other things we'd rather do. So I think as a town, the select board certainly is in on this too, and we are going to try and keep a balance in the whole work that we're taking care of the budgets of the departments and these other future liabilities that we have to make sure we don't end up in the hole in the long run.
When we say OPEB, does everybody know what we're talking about?
Nobody does.
Nobody does. It's an outlier.
Nobody does.
All right. So this is an accounting exercise that every city and town throughout the entire nation has to address. It's formerly known as GASB 45, Government Accounting Service Board, GASB. It looks at the proposition this way, that what is the total amount that we would have to pay if each and every employee retires on June 30th of any year. What is the total amount for their health insurance, their life insurance, and their dental insurance for the rest of their lives collectively? All right, so it's a big number. It's a number that'll scare your pants off if you look at it too closely. It started out in Hadley that number was somewhere close to $8 million. We've been able to whittle it down to about $6.9 million. So we're going in the right direction on it. It's not an invoice that we're ever going to get. Think of it this way. December 7th, 1941 is a date that lives in infamy. It was a Sunday, Japanese attack Pearl Harbor. I can imagine that Monday morning, people across this nation went to their bosses and said, I'm joining the armed forces, I quit, pay me now for my accumulated vacation and other leave that I've got. So on Tuesday there'd be a big payout across this nation of what had been accumulated. OPEB is not that kind of liability. It's future costs that have not yet been incurred, but we have to tally them. So under no circumstances will someone send us an invoice for $6.9 million. But we do need to pay attention to this because going back to that credit rating issue, how we're funding our unfunded future liabilities is important to credit rating agencies. So this is a project that we embarked on back in 2008. We started working on it very modestly. We put together a strategy for making quick gains on OPEB unfunded liability for a few years until we got to some magic numbers, some thresholds. We've achieved that at that point. At this point, so we're on the downslope of this. It's going to take 30 years, 20 years, something like this. This is really no different from the pension crisis of the 1980s, which we're still working on. So this is a marathon. This is not a sprint. We're going to be working on this for a long time. But the good news is that we have we've committed to a program for funding this unfunded liability that in the long term will not only be sustainable, but will also result in even a stronger financial basis for the town. So it is a crisis for the state. It's a crisis for some towns. Many towns in Western Massachusetts are ignoring this issue. They do so at their peril. We are not as good as Arlington. We're not as good as Wayland. We're not as good as Concord. But we're way, way better than most of the cities and towns in the valley. So we're on the right part. We're on the right side of OPEB funding, and we shouldn't be regarding it as a crisis. We should be looking at it as how do we sustain our strategy for approaching this and with long-term goals in mind. And when I say long-term, I'm talking measuring it in 20 or 30 year segments. That was a long answer.
Sure was.
Any other questions? So, I'd like to thank everybody for coming tonight. We really appreciate it. And October 20th is going to be an informational session for the town warrant articles. And then, of course, fall town meeting, October 27th.
Right here.
So we will see you there. Thank you so much for coming. We appreciate it.